Hi, this is Richard Wolf from Economic Update. In these difficult times, I can't imagine living in a world without KPFA. What a good stroke of luck and hard work that a station like this, courageous like this, so badly needed in these times, is available to people in the Bay Area. Please donate what you can today. It's a very worthwhile cause. This is Richard Wolf thanking you in advance for whatever you can donate.
And you are listening to 94.1 KPFA and 89.3 KPFB in Berkeley, 88.1 KFCF in Fresno, 97.5 K248BR in Santa Cruz, and online at kpfa.org. The time is 1 p.m. Stay tuned next for Your Own Health and Fitness.
Welcome to Your Own Health and Fitness. I'm health integrationist Lena Berman with Jeffrey Fawcett, and we come to you weekly with a critical independent voice on the politics and practice of health and the environment. Know what causes heart disease? Think you do? Today's show will turn everything you think you understand about heart disease around. Maybe you're suspicious about the cholesterol connection, but do you know how deep the deception runs? It's almost as though conventional medicine doesn't really want people to be protected. Still, I bet you're scared. Most people are. Today's show should alter not only your fear, but your behavior. Join us for a discussion about the great cholesterol con with Dr. Malcolm Kendrick. He is a family practitioner in the UK. He graduated from Aberdeen in Scotland. He has a particular interest in cardiology and writes for medical journals and magazines. Dr. Kendrick is an active cholesterol skeptic who believes that cholesterol has nothing to do with causing heart disease and wrote the Great Cholesterol Con. He lives near Manchester in the United Kingdom and is married with two children. And we're very honored to have you on the line with us. Welcome.
Hello there.
Hi. It's very clear when you read your book that the whole issue of what cholesterol is not at all clear. I mean, that there's a misconception about what cholesterol actually is. Do you want to start there?
Well, I think, the problem is the terminology appears to have been designed by a committee to make it impossible for the average human being to understand what anybody's talking about. Obviously, cholesterol is a chemical, which has a chemical structure, which of which I can't remember at the moment. But cholesterol is it doesn't exist in your bloodstream because, like many fatty substances, it doesn't dissolve in water, therefore blood. So cholesterol is carried around in little taxis, if you like, little spheres that have different names. And horribly confusingly, the largest of which is called a chylomicron, and the smallest of which is called high-density lipoprotein, or HDL, which most people will have heard is good cholesterol. Of course, it's not cholesterol. It just contains cholesterol. Interestingly, of course, HDL has the highest concentration of cholesterol in it of any of the lipoproteins, and yet it's supposed to be good. So we have all this weird terminology. The other substance carried around in lipoproteins is triglyceride, which is three fats attached to a glycerol, tri and glyceride. But one of the lipoproteins is also known as a triglyceride, whereas actually it's a lipoprotein. So essentially, I spent quite a lot of the book trying to explain to people what on earth I was talking about when I was talking about things.
Well, what's interesting about it is the when you do it that way, when you go in and start to explain exactly what cholesterol is and how actually we're really talking about lipoproteins and not this, sort of imagined sludge that comes running through the bloodstream and slathers itself all over our arteries, that in fact there's these little packages being transported around the body, going to the liver and various places, and that there's a sort of reason for it happening. And that the most important message, I think, in the beginning of your book is that the reason that the cholesterol, the whole concept that cholesterol causes heart disease and plaques and things like that, if you look at what cholesterol actually is and how it's transported, it suddenly actually sort of dissolves, not to use a pun, but the whole thing sort of dissolves. What is it that actually causes these plaques that people are concerned about? What is it actually made out of?
Well, it's incredibly difficult to answer that question simply, unfortunately, as you probably know if you...
No, it's not simple.
If you've read the book. But, I mean, the plaque is a term for a thickening, a bit like... I'm trying to think of an analogy, but it's like a thickening in the wall, which eventually protrudes into the what they call the lumen, and eventually restricts the blood flow. There's all sorts of things in a plaque. There's almost everything you can think of. There's white cells. There's muscle cells. There is cholesterol in there, and there are bits of lipoproteins, although it's very difficult to work out what they are. But a plaque essentially, as far as I'm concerned, is quite a simple thing. It represents an area where the artery was damaged from the inside, if you like, where the lining of the artery was stripped off. And then a small blood clot forms over that point. The blood clot is then, if you like, healed. New lining grows over it. And in most cases, that small what they call a lesion is a medical term for it, is got rid of. And quite a lot of the things that you see happening in the artery, what they call inflammation and white cell infiltration and all these things, is essentially a response to injury. So the artery wall is injured and then repair occurs. But over time, if you have repeated episodes of injury, more and more blood clots form over that point, and gradually the repair mechanisms can't get rid of all the detritus, and eventually you get, you know, like a lesion, which would be something like a boil on the skin or something like that, just full of gunk and goo and bits and pieces. But of course, you don't want those things sticking into your arteries. But that, in the simplest case, is how I believe that the plaque or the narrowing or the damaging thing occurs. And these things are operating through all stages of, from just a small blip in the artery to a very serious kind of gunky, inflammatory, nasty thing that can eventually effectively rupture, and then you get a huge blood clot, and then basically that's the end game, if you like.
When people are examined or autopsies are performed on people who have had some kind of event, and they've looked at the clots, my memory is that they don't find much in the way of cholesterol. They find inflammatory cells, which is kind of what you just said. But there's another important issue, which is what actually causes people to die when all of this happens. Because when we had you on the show some time back, what you said was the actual event that's supposed to cause a lack of oxygen to the blood actually seems to happen after the heart attack is over or something, and that it doesn't follow exactly the way people think it or have thought it did.
This is the ultimate heresy, which I'm not entirely sure about. I mean, the idea is very simple, is that basically, I mean, most people would say that what happens is you've got a plaque in your artery, and it's a kind of sticky, outy thing, and eventually that, if you like, the word is ruptures, that releases a lot of gunk from inside it. That causes a blood clot to form. The blood clot itself blocks an entire artery, and if that artery is supplying a bit of blood to your heart, then that part of the heart will effectively be starved of oxygen and will infarct. And that's a very simplistic kind of plumbing approach, which most people will tell you is absolutely the correct way that this occurs. I'm sure in some cases we seem to see that, but it's remarkable. You can quite often find people's hearts have got infarcted areas in them, and you can't find a clot. Equally, an autopsy study in Holland found that young people with no previous heart disease who came in and died of a heart attack, they then had a look at their arteries and found that really in almost 5 to 10% of cases you could find this sequence of events was blood clot, blockage, infarction. But in an awful lot, the blockage had occurred weeks before, and had cleared, and then the infarction happened several weeks after you'd had the blood clot formed. In some cases, there's no blood clot to find. So clearly, it's what's actually happening in the heart is much more complicated and difficult to understand than just this very simple block, you know, infarct death kind of scenario, which is the one that's presented. And there are people, and I've been reading what they're saying, that saying essentially that the heart muscle will infarct, or as some people call this, dying, but it obviously doesn't die because it doesn't turn into a blackened piece of necrotic tissue. It turns into scar tissue. But leaving that aside, what's happening is clearly if you put heart muscle under enough stress, then it just says, I can't cope anymore, and decides to convert itself into either hibernating or scar tissue. So it's really a fascinating process going on in the heart, and it's far from simple. And we've been given an incredibly simplistic view of how you know, cholesterol sticks to arteries, and then they narrow, and then they block, and then you die, and if you scrape the arteries out, we'll all be fine. It really is. The human bodies are far more incredibly complicated than the sophisticated piece of machinery than that.
You're listening to an interview with Dr. Malcolm Kendrick, K-E-N-D-R-I-C-K. His book is The Great Cholesterol Con, not to be confused with another book written in the U.S. This book says The Great Cholesterol Con by Dr. Malcolm Kendrick, the truth about what really causes heart disease and how to avoid it. So the key word here is stress, and we're going to get back to that. But I want people to keep that word in their head, because that's a much better explanation for what is happening in their cardiovascular system, is a response to stress. But what happens to our health statistics if pharmaceutical companies get their wish and everybody starts taking statins to lower their cholesterol to the new allowable limits, which are beyond low? I mean, they're like around 140 now here. For here, it's different measurement here in the UK. What happens to people? What happens to our health if that happens?
Well, I think my own view, and I have people write to me all the time telling me their lives have been destroyed in one way or another by taking statins. And it's clear to an extent that the more that you lower the cholesterol level, we'll call it cholesterol level even though there is no such thing, but it's a simple shorthand, if you like. And trying to reach these targets means people being put on very high doses of a substance which you've got to remember is discovered as a poison in red yeast rice, which was produced by this plant in order to kill predators. So you're giving people a dose which is getting close to the what I call the LD50, which is lethal dose 50%. No, I mean, to an extent, that's not true. But we are closing in on quite a high level of a very poisonous substance, essentially, which blocks a whole series of vital pathways in the liver and other cells. You don't just block cholesterol synthesis. I mean, if you think of a pathway a bit like a tree, maybe that's not a good analogy, but essentially it is a tree. It grows up, and then you have bigger branches and little branches. And at the end of one of these branches is cholesterol being synthesized in the liver. At the other end of other branches, you've got other things. You've got one of the most important is probably a substance called coenzyme Q10, which is a critical substance for energy production in cells. That's being blocked. I mean, that's such a critical substance that when Merck first put the patent together for lovastatin, they actually put in a patent application to provide coenzyme Q10 along with the statin, in order to overcome the problems of coenzyme Q10 depletion. They didn't act on that patent, but they clearly knew that this was a problem very early on. And if you deplete coenzyme Q10, you cause muscle weakness, you cause all sorts of weakness throughout the body. So people become de-energized, if you like, to a greater or lesser degree. And there's all sorts of other quite important substances. And I don't know how quite important. Vitally important substances that you're blocking. So this whole pathway is being blocked at a very early stage. And most of the side effects that you see are a direct result of these blockages. And increasingly, people have been looking at cholesterol metabolism in the brain and finding that if you block cholesterol metabolism in the brain, you do serious damage here. You cause glial cells, which are the primary cell in the brain, to develop into adult mature cells in one direction, and you block the production of synapses, because synapses in the brain, which are obviously the things that create memories and thoughts, are almost entirely made of cholesterol. So you're doing really, really fundamental, serious things inside the body. Luckily, the body's pretty good at overcoming a lot of these things. But in the end, if you go for lower and lower targets and higher doses of statins, people are just going to suffer an increasingly huge burden of side effects, some of which are irreversible.
You know, I have to tell you that this is, in my experience, I've read a lot of books about the issues around cholesterol. One of them is your friend, Ufi Revenskov, your friend and associate, who reviews all of the research that's been done on cholesterol. But this book that you've written, in my estimation, is the best book so far on this issue, and that the only people who have come close to writing about this as clearly, you know, explaining the science, and not only a very entertaining and funny, you're extremely funny, you're not being funny today, you're being serious, but yeah, your book is hysterical. I was reading it and laughing out loud. I read the whole book. Very beautifully written. But the point is that you explain the science, and you enable people who are reading the book to follow you along and understand why it isn't physiologically possible for cholesterol to be the culprit here, and that it's a far more complicated problem, and that the body does what it does for a reason. So the only people I've seen do this before are people like Mary Innick, whose books are very hard to read, who is a lipid researcher. These are the people who usually talk about this in the correct way. So, getting rid of cholesterol is extremely harmful, because all of your sex hormones are produced out of cholesterol. Your lung surfactant, the surface of your lung, is made out of cholesterol. Your brain works using phospholipids, which are actually cholesterol is carried in. And you can't actually function. People get higher incidence of cancer. There's some sense that cancer is associated with lowering cholesterol to lower your immune system. According to Ufi, there's been many research projects that show that the when cholesterol is lowered to the levels that the pharmaceutical companies are asking us to lower it to, that people's immune systems crash because they can't function without the cholesterol, and that people have extremely high rates of depression, which is also associated with heart attacks. So that actually heart attack risk goes up when cholesterol goes down.
Oh, yeah, well, I mean, of course, I agree. It's a fantastic book. But, I'm being serious. I mean, I've become I'm very serious about this. I wrote the book to be funny in order that people would turn a few pages and think, well, this is not too bad to read, this scientific stuff.
Oh, it's wonderful to read.
And, thank you. But the problem is, of course, then people will tend to dismiss you as being just too flippant, and I have people say, oh, we're far too flippant about something so serious. And the whole thing to me is gigantically serious, but in the end, you have to have a bit of gallows humor about it all, because otherwise I think I would just frankly go mad. I mean, I look at this and I think, hopefully in about 3 months' time, people will look back and say, we did what? We thought cholesterol was damaging and dangerous. You know, how on earth could we have been so stupid? It's more likely, unfortunately, to be in 10 or 15 years. I mean, there's a very recent study come out. I don't know if you've seen it. It's only in the last day.
About the children?
The SEAS study, which is another Vytorin study, which is showing absolutely no benefit at all, but has actually shown a significant increase in cancer risk. Mm-hmm. Of all the problems that statins may cause, this is the one that worries me the most, because, what they say is, we haven't seen any significantly increased risk of cancer in the major studies. And you'd have to say yes, but most of these studies were done in relatively young people over a five-year period. If you did a study of people smoking over a five-year period in relatively young people, you would not see a significant increase in cancer in these people. But the fact that we are actually seeing signs of increased cancer rates, there's a major Japanese study that no one ever mentions called JLIT, where actually they provided a warning where they said the people who had the most extreme hyper-responsive drops in their cholesterol level had a 350% increased risk of dying of cancer on the statin.
Wow.
So wherever you look, you see these things appearing. In all the animal studies that they did, they found that statins increase the risk of cancer. So it seems incredibly blasé, or is that the right word? I'm not sure. It might be idiotic, might be the right word, of people just to say, oh, well, you know, we've only seen a few signs of this, and most of the studies haven't shown it, and let's forget it. I mean, if the cigarette manufacturers had come out with this story, we'd be screaming blue murder. I mean, yet somehow or other, statins have reached this sort of status of hallowed wonder drug that can do no harm, and people just dismiss any possible downsides as if you are somehow an unbeliever or something, and you should be taken in front of the Spanish Inquisition and burnt at the stake for daring to question the wonderfulness of them. It's become an irrational kind of situation, in my opinion.
Well, it here, as I believe it is, to some extent in the UK, the pharmaceutical companies are, I think, the richest, maybe, I don't know, they're sort of neck and neck with the oil companies. Last time I looked, they were ahead of the oil companies in terms of being the richest industry. So they have enormous political clout, or clot, actually. One of the ways that we know that cholesterol is important for human development and protective is the studies on people who don't have enough of it. And so that's all covered in the book. I don't want to get bogged down. But, the other thing that's interesting is I'm hesitating because I want to mention also that when we were talking about cholesterol blocking the arteries and you start talking about endothelium injury and blood clots, it's very interesting to note in the book that vitamin C, which we no longer make in our bodies, wild animals do, we don't, our cats and dogs don't either, protects you from getting blood clots. Very simple thing to do, take vitamin C, I would say. So that's very interesting. And one of the most alarming clotting factors which can occur, and you explain why it occurs later. The previous idea was that this occurred because of genetic susceptibilities, and now what you're bringing up is it's not. It has the damage is being done by stress, and it's a variety of different stressors, but that lipoprotein A, capital L, capital P, small a, this is caused also. It's caused by stress and is also controlled by vitamin C in the diet. I mean, it's just, taking vitamin C, such an easy, cheap thing to do, so much cheaper than statins and indeed not harmful. The other thing that's alarming is in this country, they're starting to talk about giving statins to children 8 years old to lower their cholesterol. So there goes your brain development. I mean, that's just out the window at that point. I'd like you for just a couple of minutes, because we need to break in just a couple of minutes, I'd like you to say a word about low fat diets and cholesterol, lowering cholesterol and diet, because I know how you feel.
Well, if there's anything more stupid than the cholesterol the cholesterol causes heart disease hypothesis is that low-fat diet is in some way good for you. You've had Gary Taubes' book out in the States. I don't know how many people have read it, but I mean, for an awful long time, it's clear that fat, well, first of all, fat has no impact on what they call bad cholesterol levels in your blood. Of course, as far as I'm concerned, that's irrelevant because bad cholesterol or LDL is irrelevant. But this whole idea of low-fat diet is complete mythology. It started with a guy called Ansel Keys in the late 50s who went around a whole bunch of countries in the world and said, oh, look, people who eat low-fat diets, specifically low-saturated fat diets, are protected against heart disease. As an example of the world's most bogus study, I think this one gets the gold medal. He had data from 7 countries. He had data from 22 countries. If you look at the data from all 22 countries, there's absolutely no correlation between saturated fat in the diet and heart disease. And in fact, I've done the more recent study done in worldwide called MONICA, run by the World Health Organization. If there's one thing that is an absolute standout, it is that the countries with the lowest saturated fat consumption have by far the highest rates of heart disease. And that would be countries such as Ukraine and most of the Eastern European countries, actually. And the countries such as France, Belgium and the Netherlands in Europe, who eat more than twice as much saturated fat, have on average 1/7 the rate of heart disease. So we're talking a completely and utterly contradictory information here. And the whole hypothesis is just nonsense, because physiologically it doesn't make any sense. And the epidemiological evidence completely contradicts it. So of all the things that, of all the stupid things that have been promoted to improve our health, it is a low-fat diet.
So it's very important that people heard what you said. What you said was that in all of the research that's been done, where they go back and they look at all these different countries who are eating low-fat diets, the low-fat diets are increasing the rate of heart disease, and the people with the high-fat diets have less heart disease. So I'll leave you with that thought. We need a brief break here. This is Your Own Health and Fitness. We're on the phone today with Dr. Malcolm Kendrick, K-E-N-D-R-I-C-K. His book is The Great Cholesterol Con, The Truth About What Really Causes Heart Disease and How to Avoid It. And if you look on the web or something to try to find the book, there are two books. One is by Malcolm Kendrick and another is by somebody else. So look for the Kendrick book, because this is the one that I think is quite brilliant. I don't know about the other one. Haven't read it yet. So we've established that cholesterol is not the likely cause, or it's never been shown to be a cause. In fact, when we've looked at the overall effect of on morbidity and of statins, if you look overall, certainly absolutely no help for women. There's some controversy about whether there's help for men, but when you look at the overall effect on death, they don't help at all, probably because they cause other other types of death.
Well, I think this is the I have this constant argument even within, there is a group called the International Network of Cholesterol Skeptics, which does have a website, www.thinks.org, where other researchers and doctors write articles saying that basically it's all complete nonsense and cholesterol is completely healthy and our obsession with this substance has led to a sort of a complete madness. But I think the thing with statins is that, as I say to people when they talk about events prevented or lives saved, even when you start to use these terms, it's very misleading, because the idea that you're saving a life suggests a sort of lifelong benefit, if you like. So I have spent quite a lot of time. I've written in a couple of journals, the BMJ, saying that when they say 10,000 lives may be prevented, 10,000 cardiovascular deaths may be prevented, or 10,000 lives may be saved, to say, well, actually, no. 10,000 people might, and the very most extreme benefit range of these drugs, be extended for a few months. When I worked the figures out, and I had to use some models, basically, what you can say is that men who've had a previous heart attack taking statins in the clinical trial, there is a what they call an overall mortality benefit. In other words, you will live longer. But how large is that benefit? And when you work the figures, if you'd say that if you took a statin for 30 years, if you were a man in the very highest risk group, you may expect to gain between 3 and 4 months of increased life expectancy. When you present the figures in that way, most people go, well, what's the point of that then? To which my reply is, well, I'll leave it up to you. I'm just telling you the truth of what this benefit means in reality. But you're quite right to point out that in none of the studies done on statins has life expectancy been increased by 1 day in women, no matter what their underlying risk is. But the way that the figures are presented, it's like the world's most dodgy second-hand car salesman. I remember seeing a joke about a man selling a car to an old woman, and it's got a sign on the window saying nine careful owners, and the car's all smashed to bits, really, and the woman's looking at it somewhat dubiously, and the car salesman says, ah, yes, but the tenth owner wasn't that bothered.
Say that again?
The tenth owner wasn't that bothered.
The tenth owner wasn't that bothered.
Nine careful owners and one non-careful owner. But it, With the statins, you get this kind of 30% reduction in cardiovascular mortality. And then it goes, whoopee, as if somehow 30% of people's lives are going to be saved. And nothing could be further from the truth. I mean, once you actually say to them, yes, but what does that mean? If I took this drug for the next 30 years of my life, as I haven't had a previous heart attack, how much longer can I expect to live? And boy, will they not answer that question for you, because the answer is, you won't live any longer.
You may also have your life shortened by the use of the statin because of their other effects.
Well, I think that if you take a statin for 30 years, you probably will have your life shortened, because these long-term effects, such as cancer causation and liver function problems, will gradually build up over a lifetime, and you'll just die of one of these things. I can't say that, because no one's done a 30-year study.
But we do.
Problems emerging, and you think, well, in my view, if you are a woman or you're a man who hasn't got pre-existing heart disease, there is no point in taking these drugs. All they will do is change what's written on your death certificate. It wasn't Mary Enig, but it was one of her colleagues said, you know, if you take a statin, it will change what's written on your death certificate, but it will not change the date. So what's the point? And a BMJ article I just quoted recently said that, you know, especially in the elderly, if you take a statin, all that happens is that you swap dying of heart disease for dying of cancer. And frankly, I think I'd rather die of heart disease than cancer, but maybe other people have a different view on that. So, I mean, they are the world's most pointless drugs. They have been unbelievably hyped. The wool has been pulled over what seems to be almost everybody's eyes. And just to an incredible extent, to a mind-boggling extent, that I just look on and think, well, the world has gone collectively bonkers. I'm just going to wait until they regain their sanity, and then I can parade around the world with a big banner saying, I told you so, for the next 30 years of my life.
We look forward to that. So we're going to take a brief break. I'm Lena Berman, Your Own Health and Fitness. I urge you to please stay with us. We're going to come back to our interview about heart disease, the real cause, in just a minute or so.
I've got 90,000 pounds in my pajamas. I've got 40,000 French francs in my fridge. I've got lots of lovely lira now. The Deutsche Mark's getting dearer, and my dollar bills would buy the Brooklyn Bridge. There is nothing quite as wonderful as money. There is nothing quite as beautiful as cash. Some people say it's folly, but I'd rather have the lolly. With money you can make a splash. There is nothing quite as wonderful as money.
Money, money, money.
There is nothing like a newly minted pound.
Money, money, money.
Everyone must hanker for the bunchness of a banker. It's accountancy that waits the world around.
Round, round.
You can keep your Marxist ways, but it's only just to pay. For it's money, money, money makes the world.
Welcome back. This is Your Own Health and Fitness. I'm Lena Berman. I'm here on the phone with Dr. Malcolm Kendrick, K-E-N-D-R-I-C-K, his book, The Great Cholesterol Con, The Truth About What Really Causes Heart Disease and How to Avoid It. You can visit our website, yourownhealthandfitness.org, all spelled out, for easier extended access to our over 600 archive shows with our library card feature. And you'll find a free stream of this week's show and the usual lots more at yourownhealthandfitness.org. If you want to reach us, you should do that by email. It's admin, A-D-M-I-N, at yourownhealthandfitness.org. The reason I mentioned that you might die earlier is that all of the morbidity, early death studies on elderly people over 65, all of them, and you have them, you have all this research cited in your book. Among, but what shows over and over and over again, and these are really big studies, I mean like 51,000 people, that kind of thing, is that people with the highest cholesterol levels, no matter what the LDL ratio to HDL, whatever that nonsense is, all the people with the highest cholesterol levels are the ones that live the longest. So if you're driving your cholesterol down, you're likely to kill yourself. The other thing is that when I interviewed Duane Graveline, who you mentioned in the book The Astronaut, who wrote several books about statins and about their effect on the brain and how it, you know, sort of gets, you sort of lose your brain function, your cognitive function, what he said is that since he's a physician, is that men with previous heart events, he will give them a dose that is microscopic compared to what's being given out, maybe 5 milligrams instead of 80. So he's saying, you know, these can be used and have some effect, but you have to use these microscopic doses. That's all you need to do it. Now, that brings me to the next topic, which is what actually causes death. And one of the things that's interesting is that since the overall effect on morbidity is the longest-lived people with the ones with the high cholesterol, we might mention here that that's only true if their blood sugar was under control. So this brings us to our next topic, which is who gets heart attacks and why, or stress kills?
Well, I think it's difficult to provide a simple answer to this because, I mean, there are no doubt other things that are at play here. As you mentioned, blood sugar, although, as you know from the book, I believe that losing control of your blood sugar is a secondary result of stress.
We agree with that.
Yeah. But also, I mean, smoking definitely plays a role in heart disease. If you smoke, you increase your risk by factor of 3.
Do you want to explain how that is, why it is, what it is that cigarette smoke does to the heart?
Well, it obviously people, I know in the UK they have an advert showing cigarettes with somebody smoking it, there's sort of fat dripping out at the end, and saying, when you smoke a cigarette, each time you smoke a cigarette, fat is deposited in your arteries. And you do feel like asking the very simple question, well, how many molecules of fat does a cigarette contain? So how exactly does the fat from a cigarette get deposited in your arteries? Clearly, obviously, when you think about it, that's nonsense. But what I believe is happening with cigarettes is that cigarettes trigger the release of various chemicals if you smoke a cigarette, what it does is it activates your stress response in your brain, specifically the hypothalamic pituitary adrenal axis, which is a little bit of gunk that sits in your brain that warns you when you're about to be attacked by a saber-toothed tiger. A cigarette gives you a little message saying you're about to be attacked by a saber-toothed tiger. This triggers a stress response in the system. It causes the arteries to narrow. It causes the blood sugar to rise. It causes adrenaline and all these other chemicals to be released into your bloodstream. And all of these things attack the lining of your arteries and thus allow damage to occur.
So
smoking also increases blood clotting factors. It increases the clotting factors by a huge amount very quickly. So,
Can I just say that another way, and you tell me if I've got it right?
Right.
Is it the case that the chemicals and the actual smoke itself are causing, as you say, the body to go into a fight-or-flight response? So is it correct to say that pollutants and chemicals also cause a fight-or-flight response in the human body?
Well, I think they certainly do. I mean, the human body is a pretty, unfortunately, quite a sensitive creature. You slap things into it and it reacts, and it quite often reacts in a defense mechanism mode and fires up various fight-or-flight responses. And I think that these things, if they are just repeated insults into your system, gradually build up problems. So I'm sure that if you add, I mean, if like cigarette smoking causes heart disease, stress causes heart disease, you start adding factors in like pollution and other things to make it, your body system is less good at repairing and less able to repair itself, and problems occur. Because, as you know, one of the things that I've written about in the book is the fact that the lining in your arteries, how that is repaired and replaced, is by cells that wander around in your bloodstream called progenitor cells. They're produced in the bone marrow. And if you knock down the production of progenitor cells, then the repair of the arteries is seriously compromised. And in people who have these very low progenitor cell levels, heart disease progresses very rapidly. And there are a number of things that can do this, from steroid use, which knock these things down, problems with your kidney function, and that's another association with pollutants and damaging substances, as they affect the kidneys. The kidneys are affected the kidneys fail to send messages to the bone marrow to say produce repair substances. And when you get damage created, the repair system doesn't work properly, and you end up with an accelerated plaque growth, if you like, in the arteries.
Rolling. You've been listening to an interview with Dr. Malcolm Kendrick. It's K-E-N-D-R-I-C-K. Physician Dr. Malcolm Kendrick. He's author of two books. The one we've been discussing is The Great Cholesterol Con. He also has a book called Doctoring Data. And, of course, this is Lena Berman. Jeff Fawcett is sitting here with me. We have a novel request from you. As you know, we're in a fund drive. And you know that the situation is very, very difficult. One might call dire. There's been discussions about whether or not the station will be able to continue broadcasting full-time, whether there will be cutbacks and whatnot. So there are a couple things. One is, I just want to clarify something. It isn't the case that KPFA is really terrible at managing money. It isn't that way at all. In fact, it's quite the opposite. What's happening is that KPFA is splendid at handling money and business operations and has a wonderful GM. But there's a network that was set up after KPFA became successful. They set up a network so we could have stations everywhere that were doing this kind of groundbreaking radio programming, never done before, completely non-commercial, depending on the listeners, and non-censored and multi-viewed. And this experiment wanted to include stations all over the country. Well, unfortunately, KPFA is the most successful of all the stations. The other stations are stumbling and having trouble, and the network is stumbling and having problems, and they're leaning very hard on KPFA. So KPFA is sort of supporting the network. So it isn't the case that it's for naught. That you if you donate, oh, why should I donate if the foundation, the Pacifica Foundation, is going to be taking money? That's not the point. The point is to maintain, ideally, a whole network of stations, and certainly KPFA. And so for now, this is what we've got to do. So here's the second novel thing. The second novel thing is that today, I want you not to pledge. I want you to donate. I want you to donate at least $100 if you can. If you cannot, then please just donate whatever you can. But I want, if possible, for you to go to kpfa.org and donate. Donate the money. Don't pledge it. Donate it so that we are sure to get the money right away and that we don't have to chase after people as well-meaning as they were in the moment. But we are assured of how much money we actually have. Now, the $100 donation is based on the idea that if you would like a thank you gift, and a lot of people like that, we will give you a copy of The Great Cholesterol Con for a $100 pledge. But honestly, you and I both know you could go to your favorite bookseller website and probably get a used copy of The Great Cholesterol Con, because it's not a brand new book. It is a wonderful book, and I want you to have it. And if it makes you happy to have a thank you gift, I want you to have it. But that's at the $100 level. And if you want to give us less, you're still a voting member at $25. Any amount you do, but if you can possibly do it online, and donate rather than pledge, that would make an enormous difference. We're looking for at least 30 people to call and donate at least $100. So clearly, those of you who are flush and can afford to spend more, you already know that having KPFA constantly, all the time, is worth much more than $100 a year. It's worth a lot if you calculate how much your other media costs are, how much you're paying for your internet and your TV or whatever you're doing. It's a drop in the bucket. So people could easily give $200, $1,000, $2,000 for the year, and you wouldn't be spending much more, or you might not be spending as much as you've been spending on all your other media consumption. So KPFA is listener sponsored. It's an experiment that's been going on for almost 70 years, and we've been able to keep it going, but we hit these rough points and it gets really bad. Now, if you cannot get to a computer and you can get to a phone, please do call us at 1-800-439-5732. 1-800-HEY-KPFA or 510-848-5732. And even then, you can say that you prefer to donate rather than pledge. You can also break this up into monthly payments. You can become a monthly donator to KPFA, give $5 or $10 a month. Think of how little that is for 24/7 of KPFA with such a variety of opinions. I mean, if you don't like one person, there's someone else on the air that you absolutely adore. And this is the time to stand up and support this kind of radio, because this is really not popular right now. We are bucking so many trends. I mean, the trend is everything is podcast. Everything is in the car and podcast. I mean, you know, so maintaining listeners means that we have to maintain really good web streaming. We have to create these podcasts, and that costs money. And there's all the expenses of getting guests on the phone. And sometimes we have people who are in a remote location, and we have to pay for that hookup. There's PG&E. There's repairs on this old building that used to be brand new. There's an elevator that helps people who need help to get upstairs get there. That breaks sometimes. There's so many expenses, it would make your mind explode if you knew. And the fact that KPFA has been keeping it going so long, I mean, it's really 67 years is a really long time, considering all the greedy people on the right who want to get their hands on these frequencies. So it's KPFA.org. KPFA.org. Donate at least $100, more if you can, less if you need to, but donate it instead of pledge it. Or if you must call, it's 510-848-5732, 1-800-439-5732. But if you actually just donate the money, that's the best deal for us. That will get us where we need to go faster. That will help us maybe get the fund drive over on time. That will help us keep this network and this important flagship radio station going. But it's terribly, terribly important to do it. As you've been listening, you know from listening what it's like. So if you don't listen, you just listen to me on the radio, well, thank you. That's very flattering. We do need your money right now. And again, there are people who cannot pay. People who cannot pay, and they are not shut out. Unlike everything else in this country, people who cannot pay are not shut out on KPFA. There are people on the air who represent people who have been shut out. I mean, there are voices that you can't hear anywhere else, and they're saying it like it is. They're not holding back. They're having at. You know, there's some real serious stuff being said on the air that would not be popular on any other public radio station that have corporate sponsors that are pretty scary. You know, they're scary sponsors. Please go to KPFA.org. Give whatever you can. Give as much as you can during this fund drive and see if we can get ourselves off of this bump in the road and back to operating a little more smoothly, and as we try to sort out all the complicated nonsense of trying to maintain a radio network in an atmosphere like this one, where we need it the most. Everyone says so. So please, kpfa.org, donate, don't pledge. And if you donate $100 and you want to take advantage of The Great Cholesterol Con, which is a fabulous book, and it's funny and he's wonderful, then we're happy to send it to you. If you can manage without it, you can get the book in other ways. And it's a great book, and I do recommend it. But, you know, again, if you're in the car, if you're in this other situation, and your best shot is to get on the phone, that's 1-800-439-5732, 510-848-5732. Did I just say that twice?
No.
Okay. Donate. So what can I say? You know, it's so, you know, I hear people on the air now really, really desperate to get people to pledge during their hour. I'm an unpaid staff member. Unless I do something really horrendous, I will be here, I think. But there are paid staff at the station, and they do need to be supported. And I would say to you, please, if you like listening to my show and you feel inspired to give as you're listening to my show, I'm grateful, and it helps me know whether or not the type of programming that I do is what you want from me. But honestly, I want you to pledge for everybody. I want you to pledge for all the shows that make your heart sing. whether they make money or not. That's the beauty of this kind of network, is that we can have a broad variety of things. We don't have to have flashy things that make money. We don't have to make everything sound like it's all right. Although it's nice when people do shows where things sound like they're all right. I mean, it's nice when you can listen to the dulcet tones of Sarah Holmes talking about herbs and feel better about being part of nature. You can laugh and enjoy Carolyn Casey. You can listen to Mitch Jesuit talk about the history of where we are right now. You can hear Kat Brooks on the air talking about the seriousness of where we are in this culture right now and what needs to happen. 1-800-439-5732, kpfa.org. Please donate whatever you can, more if you can. Cover the people who cannot pay. That's the whole principle here. We're not just preaching to the upper white middle class like some other public radio stations are doing. Even small community radio stations, try as they might, cannot recruit the kind of talent that KPFA draws to it. And the years of experience, Phil Muldery, Chris Welsh, people who have been on the air, Larry Bensky, people who have been on the air for, gosh, I'm not even sure how long, because it's been almost 22 years for me. I think those guys are up into the 30, 35, 40 year range if the station is 67 years old. 1-800-439-5732, 510-848-5732. It's been such an honor for me to be on these airways after having listened to this station my whole youth and young life. And I'm honored to be able to come to you this way, in this really informal way, and say to you, I have put my time, my energy, and my heart on the line for this station for a long time because I believe in the mission and because I want to be able to talk to you without being restricted about what I say. That I can talk about controversies in the politics of health and the environment, that I can bring that to you and share it with you. And now what I'm asking is, help us sustain this very important network and station by pledging at KP, not pledging, donating, going directly to the website, kpfa.org, and donating. And if you don't want a copy, at whatever level, 100 for a copy of The Great Cholesterol Con, really amusing, wonderful, substantial book, then go ahead and donate whatever you want. Take advantage of whatever kind of thank you gifts are there, or give us a straight donation. Give the station a full donation. This will give us such a relief if you can just donate to us. We've gotten into this habit of giving you little thank you gifts. Please, the thank you gift, as you've heard so many times before, is the substantial experience and talent that you hear all the time on KPFA. People who are donating, I mean, it takes a lot to do even a weekly show. And those people who show up and do daily shows are working so hard. And it's, on a very shoestring kind of thing. And that's maybe as it should be, because it is people's radio and it has to exist. And as I said before, the forces are not in our favor, except that our listening audience, our reach is tremendously supportive of KPFA. They've come through for us every time, and we're hoping that you will be part of that movement. Go to kpfa.org, please, and either get a thank you gift. You can get Great Cholesterol Con for $100. You can pledge at $5 if you want. You can even better do $5 or $10 or $20 a month. Be a sustaining membership of KPFA. This is going to help us immeasurably if it's a straight donation. So that's what I'm asking you to do. You can, as I said, go to the phones. It's 1-800-439-5732. You could probably sing it with me at this point. But if you go to kpfa.org, just give us a raw donation. Just slap your money down on the bar, and we will give you every libation that you want on the radio. We are here for you. We are here to educate you and make you feel less alone. It's we're to talk about how precarious and difficult this human situation is that we're in, to know that our lives are finite, to know that our planet is fragile and that much of what we rely on is finite too, and to be caught in this moment of change, this uprooting of change that I haven't seen since the 60s when I was young, and the kind of momentum that's starting here, and KPFA is right in the middle of it, right in the middle of it. I mean, Amy Goodman shows up with her microphone, and, you know, she's being pursued for some kind of charges for getting in the way and doing something she's not supposed to do, and she just goes there and does it, and that's the spirit of this kind of radio. And if you've heard her talk about, you know, if you ever heard her give a speech, she talks about how the future of this type of programming is absolutely it's the most important thing we have, because everything is being closed down and censored. And for some reason, we're being allowed to just have at, but we have to keep the money coming in. 510-848-5732, 1-800-439-5732. But most of all, kpfa.org, a straight donation of whatever you can afford. If you can do it, if you can do it, pledge $2,000. If you can do it, pledge $5,000. You will be covering radio experience and education and companionship and community for all these people who have been left out and can't afford it. Most people can afford a little radio. But because we're all in this podcast world, now everything is more expensive. And so KPFA's 941 area, 941, you know, our web streaming, that's that podcasting stuff that takes it work to do. And somebody is being paid to do it. And the having, oh, it's really, you know, it's expensive. You know, nothing's free anymore, even though this station will broadcast to people no matter what happens, as long as we can. When we were locked out back in 99, I was outside in front of KPFA with a microphone and pair of headphones, streaming outside, we did radio programming outside of the station when we were locked out. Things got really serious. We were off the air for a while. Please don't let that happen again. Please help us. Whoever you are that can, you know who you are. And if you've never pledged before, there is no time like right now during this fund drive to do it. And I would be honored if you did it during my show. It would help me feel that what I've been doing is touching you in some deep way. So please go to kpfa.org. Please make a straight donation. And those of you who can't afford very much and want to throw something in, even if it's $5 a month, even if it's just $5 one time, it's helpful. Every single amount, I mean, you can go back into the back seat of your car and reach around in the pillow cushions and see what's there and donate that. But please don't let it go too long, because you know the way the world works. Most of you who listen to this station right now are suitably cynical about how much power there is being thrown around by economic interests, how powerful and how corrupt everything is, and any human endeavor is fraught with conflict and trouble, and KPFA has its share. But there's a way in which when it really comes down to it, everybody just goes and pushes against the wheel and tries to get it rolling again. And that's where we are right now. So please be part of this. I know that you are, and I know you want to be. Please go to kpfa.org, donate $100, and get a copy of The Great Cholesterol Con, or just donate $100 and go get the book at your favorite bookseller, used or something, for less. But please don't hesitate to give at this moment to KPFA. It's critical. It's just critical. And it probably may be critical again and more. But the more listeners get behind this kind of institution, the better chance we have of pushing back against this tsunami of right-wing behavior that's taking over this country. And disconnection and disassociation and just a loss of contact. KPFA is keeping it real. And we need you. We need you. You're part of the KPFA community. And it's all over the Bay Area and up and down to, you know, the Central Valley and all these other places. We're everywhere. And we need these frequencies. And we need them to survive. And we need the cash to do it. And remember, when you give us cash, we are beholden only to you. Thank you for listening, and thank you also to those of you who pledged. Thank you very much, donated during this hour. Thanks so much. This is Your Own Health and Fitness. Visit our website, yourownhealthandfitness.org, for easier extended access to our over 600 archive shows with our library card feature, a free stream of this week's show, and lots more at yourownhealthandfitness.org, all spelled out. If you want to reach us, you can email us at admin, A-D-M-I-N, at yourownhealthandfitness.org. Your Own Health and Fitness is produced by Lena Berman and Dr. Jeffrey Fawcett. Remember, being informed not only protects your health,